keep my eyes on the rest of the field and see if something happens. But it seems right now the cars are just circling this lovely evening Sebring track and just doing their things. Bernie, who we are following now, is currently something like 2.2 laps behind 10-man project. Of course, as Kasper revealed, the 10-man project car is about to pit in. So really, I think it's something like a lap and a half between the two cars. A bit too much of a gap with only 2 hours left, I'd say, if I was in the Bernie pits. There's not really much they can do to change that actively. They really need a mistake from the 10-man project, as we said earlier. And on my other screen I can now see 10-man entering the pits, so yeah, we'll wait and see how much the gap will be at that point. And 10-man is still 3 laps behind Formula Yamaha, so that is not likely to change. I mean, even if Formula Yamaha got a disconnect, they would at best be equal after the server restarts. So yeah, P1 and P2. Yeah, P1 in the GT class looks quite secure on Formula Yamaha. P2. Probably 10-man, but Bernie is still more or less within reach of it. Further down the GT class we have Jim Culling 3. They're right now 6 laps behind Bernie, as they have been for the past hour or so, which means that they as well need guys in front to make huge mistakes, like a disconnect or something. It's not 6 laps, it's not something you can make up in the course of 2 hours by just going fast. It seems to be just too much, but they are still doing everything they can. And lastly we have Kaubek Strunk in GT1. They are currently 3 laps behind Colin 3, but they actually do have a chance of beating them, seeing as how Colin has had a few driving mistakes, but so has the Germans, to be honest. So yeah, I think they might end it now, but at least they did beat the cars that had to retire due to driver fatigue. Bernie Racing now about to be overtaken by the FTZ LMP car. FTZ is the overall second right now, 1 lap behind Team Kitty. About 100 meters ahead of Bernie we have Team Culling 3. And And if Bernie does pass, that means they are 7 laps ahead of Colin 3 rather than 6. So it's not really something that's a priority to Bernie to get past, unless of course Colin 3 is going to slow them down, which might be the case. And I can say the 10-man project exited the pits a little while ago. Of course, they are who Bernie Racing are chasing, and it does amount to about a lap and a half that that Bernie is behind them, as we had expected. Bernie and Cutting just being overtaken by FTZ again. This might be what Bernie needs to be able to get past Cutting 3. FTZ's car slows them down, but it doesn't seem to be the case. The Cutting guys seem to just be going 100%. They seem quite unaffected when people are trying to overtake them. There's a bit of a Kimi Raikkonen and Iceman thing about it. A small driving mistake from Team Cutting there. Bernie is very, very close now. Beautiful overtaking from Bernie. They are now 7 laps ahead of the Cutting guys. Right now Formula Yamaha is in the pits. And that may put 10-man project within 2 laps of Formula Yamaha instead of 3. We'll see in a moment. Ooh. Germans had a small crash, but it seemed like a driving mistake from them. Oh, I can see the Germans have a flat front tire and a broken headlamp. We'll have to ask them to get that fixed. Sorry, I cannot show this to you right now, but the Germans are driving around with quite a damaged car. They're driving slowly, but quite safely home to the pits. They're taking it easy. They have a flat tire, as I said, and the front end has some damage. They hit a wall pretty hard, but the car is capable of like 90-100 kilometers per hour. So it can get home without much problems, and they're not causing any trouble for everyone. They're being nice guys and kind of keeping to one side and driving in a predictable way, which is what you really want in this situation.
Hello.
We see the Germans entering the pits now to get their damage repaired.
I think I have Lasse with me here now in the commander booth.
Yep.
Hello, Lasse. You were driving the previous stint, or was it double stint, of the Formula Yamaha Lister Storm, is that correct?
It's only single stints. We've been single stinting all day in Peter.
Yeah. So, I believe I heard something about you trying to set some fast laps. How did that go?
Rubbish, to be honest. The record is 1 minute 54 seconds, 0.232, and previously we had 0.292, and I've gotten down to 2.63. So, at the moment we are talking hundreds of seconds.
Alright, it does seem like most people are starting to do quite consistent lap times, as long as they're not making too many mistakes, and that seems to especially be the case for you. Is this one of your favorite tracks, or how does it rate?
To be honest, I haven't really driven a lot on Sebring before, but after the new version from Virtual LM has come out, it's really a really nice track to race on. The circuit is so detailed, and the bumps and the details in the tarmac and the concrete parts of the circuit is really impressive. And that all adds to the experience and makes it a lot more fun to drive.
It's definitely a beautiful track, and compared to the previous Sebring tracks I've seen for GCR2, this is just an enormous improvement. This is like it's like better than the standard tracks that come with the game.
A lot better.
It's amazing.
And, it really is amazing. Virtual M is a bunch hard getting the grips on. They don't really say a lot, and the website is awfully old and outdated. But they put out, without a warning, they put out a track or a little mod now and then. And the things they make for the G-Motor games is just amazing.
Yeah, I had to agree on that. That's good job on them.
And it's a lot prettier as well than our Le Mans circuit. Even though we've put a lot of work into making that better.
That one is improved immensely as well. Perhaps a better improvement than this one is seen. But still, this is it is in a different class, you'd have to say.
It is indeed.
right now I can see a 10-man project doing half a second faster lap than Formula Yamaha, and they're just struggling to unlap themselves, so they'll be two laps behind instead of three. So, yeah, they are going fast. Is it fast enough? Probably not. But definitely going for it. I think Kasper is out to set the fastest lap of the race in the GT car as well.
Well, the fight, let's just say that the fight for the fastest lap isn't over yet.
Yeah, we'll see. Right now, he is going pretty fast, and yeah, seeing as he probably will keep getting faster for a little while still, as he gets less fuel and weight in the car, he might actually set a good time sometime soon.
Yeah, to my experience, the cars are at their quickest at the beginning of the stint, the first 20 liters or so. After that, the tires fade off too much for at least with our car.
Yeah, that it can vary though with the tire choices, stuff like that. But I guess this is a pretty rough track for the tires, right?
It's rough on the cars with all the bumps and the unevenities, given that it is most of the big parts of the circuit is, as I've talked about earlier, part of the old airport, or the airport base. That means it's quite rough concrete that you're driving on, and it demands a lot from both your tires, but also your suspension and your dampening.
I'd say that just what you just mentioned is one point where even the best racing simulator and the best track kind of falls short of the real thing, because when I'm watching real Sebring races, you always hear the drivers and commentators talking about how bumpy the track is, that it's like driving over big speed bumps and rocks and stuff, and it's this and that bumpy. And I can kind of sense it and see it in the game, but you don't really feel the bumps in the same way you would driving over them in a real car going 250 kilometers an hour plus. That's one point that you really miss out here. If no one had told me there was bumps on it, maybe I wouldn't even notice. If they wanted to make it really, really noticeable in the game, it would have to be too extreme, to an unrealistic degree. So that's somewhere that that the simulation kind of falls short.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's very hard to replicate in a simulator. Even though I'm not too fond of it, the game that does the best job of replicating this is iRacing. That's probably the closest you get, but that's probably because they laser scan their tracks, and that gets you every single little bump and bend in this track surface into the simulator.
That would make sense. That's the way to go, I guess. Because I think in GTR2, for most of the tracks, the tracks are just kind of flat, made from satellite photos or whatever, and then the bumpiness of the road is more or less defined in a general way, that this track is a bumpiness of, say, 5 or something. Maybe you can go more into detail on that later.
You could say, as you say, most, by far the most of in actually any track in a G-motor based game is done by tracks are scratch made. They're not scans, they're not copies of a real track. They are scratch made and then cross referenced with GPS data and satellite photos, as you said, stuff like that. Very precise GPS data, mind you, but nonetheless it's not a scanned track as it is with a laser scanning. A laser scan track of the quality that iRacing is using. Their fidelity is I think they say is accurate down to a millimeter of elevation. So it's incredibly detailed in a laser scan track, and you just don't get that amount of detail in your own surface in these games. The only G-Motor game I know of that uses laser scanned circuits, that is that new thing, Sim Raceway, that has just popped up. I think some of their tracks are laser scanned, but that's the only G-Motor 2 game that has laser scanned circuits. But as you said, I think you're right. At least scan circuits are a lot more detailed than probably that is the way of the future.
I mean, what we have now was absolutely amazing when it came out. But I'm guessing that in the future we'll be driving something that's as realistic as this or better with the laser scanned tracks and lots of other nice things, which I'm looking forward to. Hard to imagine the quality getting worse. How would they sell such a thing?
Yeah, that's a fun subject, to be honest. In other branches, I've noticed the simulator thing isn't as huge as it has been. It's kind of like I see that as a tendency that the developers started out very hardcore. As all of you know, all of you who've driven it at least, GTR 1 was extremely difficult to drive, just simply because the tire models were actually too hardcore. The tires would just slip on you with no warning. And if you ever catch the slide, it was worth the YouTube video.
Exactly.
Then came GTR 2 that we're racing now. That came out in 2006, I believe. And while GTR 2 was immense back then, we are missing a lot of features in it. And GTR 2 has a shitload of really, really weird errors and ways it behave. And it's not really suitable for mudding, to be honest. Unless you really know what you're doing, because it's so sensible to tiny little mistakes. One tiny little mistake in a material name in a part of a 3D model or something like that can destroy so many things. That can render a car useless, and if a car is useless, that can, we've seen it in some rare cases, just crash an entire server.
We have seen our fair share of GTR 2 problems, so it'll be exciting to see what the future brings.
Yeah, and on my part, I'm looking a lot more to see if any of the two new big simulators is what we're hoping it to be. Of course, R-Factor 2 would be a contestant, and I'm also very excited to see what GTR 3 will become. People like us, I don't know about you, but I'm really looking for the ultimate endurance simulator. What I want to be able to do is extensive damage modeling and things like, instead of the longest pit stop we can do right now in GTR 2 as it is right now is, I think, 2 minutes or something along those lines. That's the most damage you can get. I think it would be extremely cool if things like, we say, a transmission could fail, and then you could be put in the pit lane for, I don't know, half an hour or something like that, and they would swap the swap the transmission, you could drive on again. That way you'd have a lot less problems with people DNFing on behalf of damage and stuff like that. We've kind of have dumbed down the damage in GTR 2 to make everybody able to finish the race. One example of that is that if you rip off a wheel mounting base, a spindle or something like that, a part of the suspension, an A-arm for example, if you rip that off, the mechanics in GTR 2 are not able to refit the damn thing. In real life, it might take 10 or 5 minutes to pull out the pins and put in a new pair of A-arms and an upright, and then put the wheel back on again. But at GTA 2, that's just not possible. So we have had to make it so that even if you crash into a wall and the car is exerted to an acceleration of 1,000,000 G's, the wheels cannot fall off and the engine cannot be killed because the engine can't be fixed either.
Yeah, that's really a shame that GTA 2 has those faults. What I really would love to see was the physics model going beyond the weight of the car and the wheels and the suspension, and going into things like oil sump damage and that kind of thing. So, say you would get like an oil leak, and that would increase your engine wear until you replace your sump, or you could get as you mentioned, transmission failures and different. Lots more different kinds of damage, and some could even take half an hour to fix, but they would be able to fix any damage as long as you could make it back to the pits. It's just a matter of how long does it take.
Yeah, exactly.
Unless the driver dies, well, that's another thing that might be possible to conceivable to add, that there's some kind of maximum G-force the driver can endure.
That would make sense,
I'd say, or even fire or something like that in the car.
That might be a bit macabre, but yeah, of course it could be an element. The things we're really looking for is a lot more options during the pit lane during the race. You're very limited in GTA 2. What I mean is, what we want to see is the ability to change tire pressures, change things like the splitter and the rear wing angles, and other quick things like some cars have adjustable anti-roll bars. If you were able to do those things in the pit lane, that would make things like adapting to the weather much more realistic, because as GTA 2 is now, if it begins to rain now in 10 minutes, everybody will have to go in and then change to wet slicks, of course. But the problem is that you cannot turn down anti roll bars to make the car more manageable in the wet. And that's things really missing if you use the simulation as an endurance simulator, that like we are doing.
It sure is.
But along those lines, if we are racing in GTA 2 at the next 24-hour race, guy we have on the team, actually the guy behind the whole GTA 24-hour thing, Kasper Hedegaard, he has figured out the addresses of the game in the RAM memory, where a lot of things about the car is stored, and it seems that with the right tool and with a little bit of hacking finesse, you can actually change things like the spoiler and other similar things in a pit stop. It's just a matter of programming the right tool.
Yeah, this is something I've been in a dialogue with Kasper about, and something we may want to do, because we definitely are missing some more possibility in the pits. The 24-hour race especially is a lot about the pits, and I think the amount of work that goes into the pit efforts is more or less as big as what happens in the driver's seat, and giving the pits some more opportunities to make adjustments on the car setup depending on the experiences you get in the training and the race would be a huge improvement. And I only hope that GTR 3 and or R Factor 2 will have the possibility to do a lot more stuff in the pits, because that would just be awesome. I want to be able to adjust ideally everything in the setup in the pits, and have the external pit crew order what could be done, and then the more things you want to change, the more longer time it takes.
That would be cool, yeah. And basically something along the lines of a bit like what Netcar Pro does, there's I think in a couple of there's timed repairs and time like tire changes and suspension swaps and things like that. I think NECA Pro is the only game that's kind of dealing with the pits in that way, but not nearly anywhere near enough. And of course, NECA Pro can't be used.
Yeah, things right, for sure.
Yeah, but NECA Pro is interesting, but not for me in the way that it can't do anything near what we wanted to do, like this thing. There's no night racing, there's no almost no GT cars. I'm not even sure there's rain, actually.
No, me neither, but it's a nice view of things hopefully to come, and a nice proof of concept, and I'm sure if you are driving small Formula cars and enjoying that, it's amazing games. Or simulator, I would say.
Yeah.
I might hurt some feelings by calling these things games.
It's a bit harsh calling NETGAR Pro a proof of concept, to be honest.
Well,
NETGAR Pro is a really complete game, but it's just not the kind of thing that we need for this kind of racing.
Well, for us, I meant it was a nice show of things to come.
Yeah.
Future.
And I'm really sure that we're hoping that Simbin is going to stop what we see as a tendency to dumb the simulation down and instead go in a more hardcore direction. But I'm afraid that dumbing simulations down is the trend the last couple of years. Take an example with Microsoft and their flight simulator franchise, which has been killed off, and now it has been reinvented, so to speak, as Microsoft Flight. And Microsoft Flight is nowhere near as much as a simulator, it seems, from the few beta experiences I've read, as the old games. For example, you're limited to, as far as I know, a single or a couple of different islands somewhere in the Caribbean, and the rest of the world just isn't modeled.
Yeah, I think the reason that kind of thing is happening is that if you go back 10 or 20 years, then all games or simulations were quite unrealistic because of poor physics and graphics and so on. They weren't that immersive, they were quite arcadey, all of them. And then a lot of developers and players were kind of thinking, I think, that the more realistic they can make it, the better it'll be. But then what actually happened is that some games, I think that's kind of a curve that is true to some extent, but after it reaches a certain level of realism, going more realistic will attract one kind of audience, but for a very broad audience it can be too realistic because it then becomes boring. For instance, a war-based shooting game or something, if it's too realistic, then when you get shot you die and you can never play anymore, or you can't play anymore that day or something, and that's maybe not as much fun and won't sell as much. So I think it's all about the money, but of course for the most hardcore, then we are kind of playing a niche here. DCR2 is not anywhere near as big as something like Gran Turismo or one of the other more arcadey games.
No, it's nowhere near as big as you mentioned, Gran Turismo or Forza, or for that matter, R-Factor.
Yeah, if we do something as simple as going to Facebook, I can see that Gran Turismo has 1.2 million likes, and GTR2 has 5,000 or 6,000 likes. So obviously, if you are a game developer and you want to make big bucks, that's something you're going to consider.
Of course, and because, as you said, if you make a very hardcore game, I think your base of customers will be very limited. But I hope at some point something like that is going to come up anyway, as there are a few developers really making hardcore simulations. Of course, we're hoping for GTR 3 to be our next new game, because GTR 2 is missing out on a lot of things, not just those features we spoke about, but also It's very sensible with regards to the network code, and the network code is nowhere near as stable or smooth as you can make a network code today. Network code today, 5 years later. Sorry. Just look at iRacing. Again, I don't really fancy iRacing primarily because of the ridiculous pricing, if you ask me. But it is a really, really good simulator, and especially I'm in love with their netcode because it's so smooth and you can see every little thing and it's hopping and jumping in the suspension, and it's really beautiful. It's a lot better than what we have here in GTR 2.
Sounds good. Oh, and by the way, Les, I think we have a 12-hour race running here still. We have right now an hour and a half left. And I thought we might take a few moments to just look at the action and see see what's going on.
I hope our viewers have been just as interested in this little discussion here, because in the meantime, you've only been looking on two different cars.
We actually now have Team Kitty DK in front in LMP. And
yep, still.
They are only now about 300 meters. Yes. No. Wrong. Actually, FTZ is a bit behind. They are actually...
That was what we said. Yeah, Team Kitty is in front. Team Kitty is on first position right now. Team Kitty is on lap 286, while FTZ is on 285, but there's not an entire lap between them. There's a gap of 1 minute and 44 seconds. FTZ, I think they've unlapped themselves, actually. At the moment, the FTZ car and the Kitty car, their last lap times are very close to each other, but the best lap time of the FTZ car, that has improved quite dramatically. Around 1.5 seconds, I think.
It has. I'm guessing they have by now put their strongest driver in, maybe with the ambition of finishing the race. Not something I know at all, but I think they are really going to go for it now, try to regain their P1 position. Moving on to GT.
Yep. So that's just to round that off. That's the positions in LMP1. That's Team Kitty in front, and the FTZ car on position number two. That's actually all the LMP cars we have left.
Yeah. And in GT, we still have quite a few cars. The first GT car and third overall is Formula Yamaha in the Lister Storm. Only 5 laps behind the LMPs, which is amazing, I'd say, after 10.5 hours. The Formula Yamaha is right now doing the fastest GT cars, so it's looking quite secure.
The Formula Yamaha at the moment is around 0.5 seconds quicker, comparing the last lap. Lap times than the quickest man of the opposition, which is of course the 10-man Project 4GT, which is on second position. Let's just find him. There he is. He's in the picture now. That is of course the 10-man Project 4GT, consisting of Kasper Hougaard and Chris Dons Johansson, and they are still. It depends a bit on pit stops and where on the lap they are, but one or two laps behind the Formula Yamaha car.
I think two or three, actually. It has been three laps for quite some time. I think sometimes it goes to two laps, depending on the famous rubber band effect of the pit stops, which are not totally synchronized because of the Lister Storm being very economic.
Yeah, as I believe, the Lister Storm is able to go, I think, two or three laps further on a tank of petrol. Anyway, moving on through the grids. You want to take the next one?
Yeah. The next car is Team Bernie Racing in the Ferrari 550. They are currently about a lap and a half behind the 10-man project. It also varies, of course. About 2 hours ago, they were neck and neck with the 10-man project.
Yeah, that was only like 10 seconds between them.
Yeah, well, actually, they did swap places a couple of times, so it was really the best racing we've seen tonight. I'm not sure exactly what time it was at, so I can't tell you which YouTube clip to look at, but I'm thinking something like 8 o'clock tonight or something. It was...
That sounds about right.
It was just amazing fighting between those guys. But unfortunately, Bernie is a bit behind now. I think they really, really, really pushed that car to keep up, and it hurt their tires, and you could see them kind of sliding about. So they probably realized that they couldn't, that they at the end of the day couldn't keep that kind of pace. Perhaps the setup in the Ferrari isn't as good. It'll be interesting to hear from the drivers later what happened. But anyway, is there about a lap or just over a lap behind?
So yeah, even though the Formula Yamaha is quicker, the times that the 10-man project 40T is doing, they are really horrendously quick. So it's very hard for the other cars to keep up.
For sure, 10-man is as we mentioned, Kasper is probably going for the best lap of the race, and for the laps he doesn't go for that one, he's still going for the hope that he can take P1 in GT. So everyone except for him in GT is going to have to go really fast to just to keep up.
Funny you should mention that. The best lap time in GT1, still 1 minute 54 seconds and 2.232. That hasn't been beaten. That's an old time, actually. That's around 6 hours old, I think. That's from some time in the afternoon, that time was set.
That's right. And that was Kasper, I believe.
I think so, yeah. He's usually a tiny bit quicker than Chris is, and which is also visible in the DDGTL series.
Yeah. Oh, anyway. Bernie has a bit of a spin there.
Just a slight bite of the dust. Doesn't seem like he damaged the car.
No, the headlights are alright at least. That's what we care about in the race control.
Anyway, let's not come to a complete halt here. Let's move down the list. The next competitor is the Aston Martin DBR9 from Team Colding Racing number 3. In the 24 hour race, quickest Team Colding Racing car, and they were actually very competitive, but not so much on Sebring for some reason. Driven by Team Chief Ben Jewell together with his teammates Brian Nielsen.
If we look at some of the best laps, they are definitely up there with some of the good cars. They can go really fast.
But it seems, No doubt.
Seems it's a little bit of a hit or miss thing. They have a bit too many small driving mistakes going on the grass and stuff like that, and getting small dents in the car that hurt the aerodynamics. But I can see them getting better every time I race them, and they are really fast now. So, I think in the future we'll see a lot more of those guys.
Yeah, it's exactly as you say. They have their car and their drivers have the potential, but their pace isn't really up there to be in the top 10, or in the top 3 rather, sorry.
Yeah, everyone is in top 10, so...
Yeah, there's only 5 GT1 cars.
Yeah.
Anyway, the last GT1 car is still our German friends, Frank Kaubeck and Jan Strunk. They are by now actually 5 laps behind the Team Colding Racing car, which renders them almost 20 laps, 18 laps behind the number one car in DC1. But still, as we've talked about numerous times before, they have, these two guys have improved a lot since October, when they were participants in the 24-hour race as well.
For sure, for sure. They are, I think if we had a biggest improvement award, it would be these guys.
Yeah, it would definitely be these guys, or Nikolai Pedersen and Hamsalia Mekko in the Team Kitty car.
Right, yeah.
You have to remember that the drivers of the Team Kitty car, Nikolai Pedersen or Nikolai Weber, depending on where you see his name. He's too digital at least. He's a new guy this season, and Hamsalia Mekko, I've never seen him before, and they are actually in front right now, in front of pretty seasoned guys like Henning Pedersen and Gerd Nielsen.
Sure, but I think the Team Kitty drivers, you easily forget that they are kind of new to this league and stuff. They have fit in very fastly, and they are nice guys, and they are doing extremely good racing, and it seems like they've just been here forever, and they just know what they're doing, and I guess they are, because they're in the lead.
No doubt, and to be in the front, the setups the LMP1 cars come with in Armat, they are absolutely bonkers, they're nothing worth, so you have to know something about the setup as well. Which is probably, I think, the hardest part of driving the LMP1 cars is actually setting them up so they'd run well. And what I believe we saw was that the Team Ezion Lola car, he was incredibly slow, and I think he had set that up wrong with way too much downforce, because of course downforce is a way of calming the car down and making it easier to drive, but it also gives you a lot of drag, and it was just too much, and on the straightaways he couldn't really pull away from the DT1 cars.
Yeah, I think that's true, and on what you said about the setups, I very much agree. From a lot of experience driving the GT cars, I know you have quite limited setup possibility compared to LMP. I mean, if you put the wings in the mid-range, you're pretty much in there, but going from 2 clicks on the front splitter to 10 or 15 clicks of possibilities, It does make a difference, and it's a lot harder deciding on low or high downforce compared to, or it's much harder to decide on 20 levels of downforce compared to just low or high, which is basically what you get in the GT cars.
Exactly, and there's several more aspects to that whole thing, because the GT1 cars in between a setting of 5 on the rear wing is pretty much the same on the Lister than as it is on a Maserati, whereas in the LP cars we have no idea what 5 is. 5 might be 100, 5 might be 2, so you have to experience with every single car and get to know what it does, and some cars are easier to set up than others, of course.
What's interesting there on that note as well is that also applies to other things. So that when you set your springs to 300 newton meters on one car, it might have to be
1,000 on another.
It exactly, because the geometry might be different. So that spring might be pushing on a longer or shorter lever, so to speak. And if you ever used a crowbar, you know how much of a difference that can make. So you can't just copy one setup from one car to a different car. And you already can't copy a setup from one track to another, so it becomes very involved. And I think if you're going to win in LMP here, that means that you at least understand quite a few of these mechanics. And
yeah,
that's
you
very
need
good.
You need to have need to have the grips on the basics of setting up a car. The LMP1 car is also a bit tricky, because you have to set them up, so this balance between being able to go slow and go quickly is also right, especially on a track like this with some slow corners. The LMP cars have the tendency to behave like a Formula 1 car or another open wheel car, which is really dependent on downforce, and that is, well, if you're not going quick enough, you're not getting downforce enough, so you're not getting temperature in anything, and you're not able to go anywhere near quick enough. So it's sometimes it's just a matter of actually throwing your fear out the window and just going for it, then it's actually much better and much easier than it is going slightly slower and more cautious.
Yep.
So, of course, if anybody out there it wants to race with us, you're very, very welcome, even though we are called DGCL, the Danish Grand Touring League, and the 24-hour event, LAN event, is held in Denmark. There's no reason that you need to be a Dane to participate, of course. Just look at our two German drivers here. But our tip, me, Lasse, and Alex here, our tip to you would be that if you want to participate with us, and you're very welcome, you have two options. Drive a GT1 car, especially if you're new to this, or if you really want to drive an LMP car, ask help for the setup with somebody else, because we know a bit about it after all, and we're very keen to help to get more participants, of course.
Yeah, in any case, just logging on to our server, which has no password, on a normal evening, there'll oftentimes be someone on TeamSpeak, and people are more than happy to help, and they don't mind giving you their setup and stuff like that. So it's a really, really good place to get started with sim racing. We've seen lots of people really improve immensely in a short period of time.
Yeah, exactly. That's always been the spirit of DGCL. DGCL has, I think, a 6-year-long history by now. And it's always been like everybody is friendly, everybody helps each other with setup and stuff like that. And secrecy about your setup and your tactics, that's only a few days before the race, and it stops right after the race.
Yeah.
I remember at some of the 24-hour races was actually set in the hours after the race, and swapped setups and cars just to try out what the other teams had.
Yeah, that's always been fun. To get back to the race, right now we have Bernie Racing and Culling 3 very close.
Roger that, I will change the camera.
Of course, Culling 3 is 6 laps behind, but yeah, Bernie just...
Bernie is flying on the inside there.
Just got him.
Bit too slow, sorry.
But no problem overtaking there for Bernie. Who's driving right now, but their pace is actually excellent. His last lap was a 1:56, and the Formula Yamaha did about the same, but then everyone else is at 1:58, 1:59, 2:03. So he's quite strong right now in D.
No doubt about that. They do have the pace, but I'm not quite sure. They have had some problems and a few crashes, I think, and they did of course also have a disconnect, which cost them a few laps in the beginning of the race.
I think they have one of those setups that I also tend to make a lot of the time, where you can kind of push the car to do some fast laps and have some really fun combat, but over a long endurance race, it's probably just not there. That's my theory at least, because what I did see when he was chasing Kasper was that in the slow corners he was getting quite sideways and so on, and he was kind of using some of those techniques I can recognize from myself when I'm not prepared enough, that you can push the car beyond its limits for so much time, but over a period of hours you can't get away with it, because at the end of the stint you lose speed and you lose some stability on it. It's a hard thing to do, to hit that magical setup where you can just push the car and it just keeps doing consistent lap times, and once the tires get worn, they do it in a way that the car still feels the same as in the beginning, only it's a few hundreds slower. That's hard to achieve, and I don't think they have done that, because otherwise they would have been right up the 10-man project Ford's tailpipe right now. That's just my theory.
And I'm not sure about one of the drivers, but at least one half of the team, Michael Bernberg, he's a seasoned sim driver, to say the least, and he's been with DGCL for quite a few years by now. And he's a veteran guy. He knows how to drive these things.
For sure, it'll be DGTL's 7-year birthday in March, I think, this year. And while he hasn't been here from the start, I think he got here after a year or two. So yeah, he's definitely been around all the big tracks.
He's been racing with half a decade.
Yeah,
think
exactly,
about that for
exactly.
A moment.
That puts things into perspective.
It really does.
Yeah, in this league we've seen kids grow up to be men, and we've seen men fall down and cry after a bad loss and so on. So yeah, we've seen it all.
Yep, we've seen it all. There's nothing more to see here. Close it down. No, well, of course, that's just joking. The time between the races is just waiting, right?
That's the spirit.
Anyway, if we might forget this race that's going on for a moment, I'd like to come back to a thing we were talking about earlier. And that was that even though there's not a lot of money in it, there are a few developers making really hardcore simulations for people that likes that kind of thing. And I think they are like pioneers. It's kind of a niche. And it's something you only do. It's not because of the money. It's just because you really want. And I think that shines through in those simulators and all those games. If you'd rather, things that pop into mind is things like Rise of Flight, Digital Combat Simulator, both the A10 thing and the Black Shark Simulator. Also, it's a company called HA Simulations. If you're interested in Microsoft Flight Simulator. And they do immensely detailed warbirds, World War II warbirds for the simulator, and that simulates everything. It's like you can overboost engine, it can blow, you can have oil leaks, it can catch on fire, some of the laser stuff they've made, you can even make pressure tests of the cylinders and swap out cylinder rings. Everything is modeled. I think it's really cool that, even though there's no money in it, there are a few developers still making that kind of thing.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's what we want to see for sim racing as well. And we are, all of us, I think, keeping our eyes open on what's happening with cars and R-Factor 2 and GTR 3. And I think as soon as we can see something that's in every way better than GTR 2, we will make...
We will make a swap, of course. If any, so something can do what GTR does now, GTR 2 does now better than GTR 2, we're swapping, because I think we're pretty tired of GTR 2 with all the flaws and bugs. And as you can tell, of course, we've had a lot of server restarts doing this race. Things like that we'd like to get out of. And of course, we can mod the game and change it and make it specific for the purpose we wanted to do, but only so much.
We have used or done quite an effort to work around all the flaws of GTR 2, like with this timing software that can handle the server restarts and our specific procedures for the safety car and so on. So we make it work and create a good atmosphere, and everyone knows what to do and so on. But of course, it'd be nice to get rid of those things to move more of the focus to the racing. That's for sure.
Of course.
And speaking of racing, Team Kitty is right now chasing FTZ. If they get past them, and they are pretty close, they will be 2 laps ahead instead of 1.95 laps, as I think they are now. So that'll be good for them, because in case we have a server restart or something like that, you can lose a lap or two or three. So being a full 2 laps ahead would be good for the security of their victory. Last lap, Kitty was 2.9 6 seconds faster than FTZ, so we might see them pass on this lap.
Oh, and I've actually just seen... Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm speaking of something different again, but I've actually just seen, with regards to what we just spoke about, that both, it seems the beta of R-Factor 2 has gone live, as far as I can tell, and those guys I was talking about,